The country tonight is in the midst of what may be the most serious constitutional crisis in its history. The president has fired the special Watergate prosecutor, Archibald Cox, and he has sent FBI agents to the office of the special prosecution staff and to the attorney general and the deputy attorney general, and the president has ordered the FBI to seal off those offices. That's a stunning development, and nothing even remotely like it has happened in all of our...
The committee will come to order, and counsel will call the first witness.
Mr. John W. Dean III.
Stand up and raise your right hand. Do you swear that the evidence that you shall give...
John Dean alone had testified that the president was criminally involved in the Watergate cover-up.
The meeting with the president that afternoon with Haldeman, Ehrlichman, and myself was a tremendous disappointment to me because it was quite clear that the cover-up, as far as the White House was concerned, was going to continue.
Dean's version of a series of meetings with Nixon was repudiated by the White House. Cox needed proof. Then the most improbable and complete proof came to light.
Mr. Butterfield, are you aware of the installation of any listening devices in the Oval Office of the President?
I was aware of listening devices. Yes, sir.
When were those devices?
The revelation that the president had had all his meetings automatically recorded meant that the tapes must contain the answer to the key question: was the president directly involved in the cover-up? He refused to surrender the tapes to the special prosecutor.
It therefore becomes my duty promptly to seek subpoenas and other available legal procedures for obtaining the evidence for the grand jury. We will initiate...
On behalf of the grand jury investigating Watergate, Cox slapped a subpoena on the President of the United States, ordering him to come to court and bring 9 specified tapes with him.
One day, Mr. Cox came to us in the jury room and said to us that Mr. Nixon wasn't going to honor the subpoena and what do we want to do about it.
Notching up the pressure, Cox got the grand jury to vote for an order enforcing the subpoena. But the judge told Cox that this unprecedented case called for a breach of the rule of grand jury secrecy.
My jaw figuratively dropped when he said to me, "Well, Mr. Cox, I don't really doubt your word, but I think I shouldn't simply accept what you say about the grand jury's vote. I ought to have them in open court and poll them."
Come on, Jim.
It was a marvelously symbolic scene.
Very good. He's walking back.
There were the 19, 20 grand jurors lined up. They'd be the first 20 people you met on the street, some black, some white, some employed, others without jobs, old, so forth.
We were really adamant in our position that we had a right as the grand jury people to hear what was on the tapes. And they were really in what we thought were in the public domain. We thought they weren't President Nixon's tapes. We thought they were the public's tapes.
The court, after hearing the presentation, signed the order to show cause. It is returnable August 7 at 10 a.m.
Nixon's lawyers argued that the president's work and that of his successors would be imperiled if judges ran roughshod over the confidentiality of presidential meetings. His high principles happily coincided with his self-interest. The tapes Cox had subpoenaed were the ones in which the president and his aides plotted the cover-up. The most damning was a discussion with John Dean about paying hush money to the Watergate burglars.
It will compound the obstruction of justice situation. people around here are not pros at this. I mean, this sort of thing mafia people can do.
Each day, a president of the United States is required to make difficult decisions on grave issues.
It'll cost money. I would say these people are going to cost $1 million over the next few years. Mm-hmm. Well, I think that we're...
One thing is, you can get $1 million, and you can get it in cash. I know where it can be gotten.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's not easy.
This kind of frank discussion is only possible when those who take part in it know that what they say is in strictest confidence.
That argument really doesn't prevail. A president, we don't think, would be held by a court to have the right to have secret criminal conversations.
It wasn't only in his pursuit of the tapes that Cox took on the president. His sweeping remit required him to investigate all presidential abuses. Even the purchase of Nixon's California home at San Clemente was open to Cox's scrutiny.
This outraged the president. And he asked me to tell Elliot Richardson in no uncertain terms that this was not the role of the special prosecutor.
Attorney General Richardson called up and asked me to come over, summoned me over to his office.
Nixon could make Richardson his messenger, but he didn't realize the way these two Boston Brahmins would talk to each other.
He was counting on me to understand that he was doing the president's bidding, and that he was also counting on me to understand that he was counting on me to exercise my own judgment and do as I thought right.
Nixon was not so understanding.
The president really had concluded, as he watched Cox go about his duties, that this was a battle to the death, I think, and he said in my hearing, I'm going to get rid of this man.
Before he could act, another scandal paralyzed the presidency. Spiro Agnew, the vice president, was under investigation for taking bribes when he had been governor of Maryland. When the attorney general was satisfied there was a case, he briefed the president on the details.
I thought the president would be deeply shaken, but his first reaction was, oh God, you know, that doesn't surprise me. All the Maryland politicians are like that.
Nixon asked the head of the Justice Department's criminal division, Henry Peterson, to double-check the evidence. Peterson and Richardson reported back. The case was solid. They had testimony Agnew had continued to take bribes even in the White House. One of the many contractors who testified said that when he went to the vice president's office, he handed him an envelope containing approximately $10,000 in cash.
Peterson, not in anger, but in sorrow, said that it was his professional judgment that the charges first were serious. He went on to say, and Richardson strongly said this too, that they would have to recommend a prison sentence for Agnew.
Here he is. I just asked where you were.
With the right-wing Agnew as his running mate, Nixon had won two presidential elections. Now, Nixon could do nothing to help him.
Even if they were framing Agnew, there wasn't any question after hearing Peterson and his version that he was frankly going to get it.
Nixon sent his chief of staff to tell the vice president he must resign. But the man from Baltimore wouldn't go quietly.
In the process of pressuring the vice president, it became very clear that he saw me as part of the problem. And I jokingly said to my wife one night, I said, if I suddenly don't show up tomorrow night for dinner, you better look into the most recently constructed bridge pilings on the Baltimore Bay Bridge.
Because of Watergate, a presidential resignation no longer seemed impossible. In that event, this vice president would automatically succeed. That was the nightmare scenario for the Justice Department insiders.
Well, the fear I think we all had was that if we went forward with a prosecution, that we'd have the Vice President of the United States sitting on the witness stand, raising his right hand, swearing to tell the truth, when the doors of the courtroom would burst open and in would come somebody saying the President of the United States has just resigned. You've got your hand up all right, but we want you to take the oath of office.
The prosecutors didn't really have a choice. The Vice President had to be brought to justice. But when Richardson and his constitutional expert, the Solicitor General, decided to indict, that is, prosecute Agnew, the President's staff tried to stop them.
It went on for about an hour and a half. Neither side gave way at all. And Haig said, all right, let's go see the President. Well, at that point, Richardson and I said we have to stop in the men's room. We didn't have to, but we wanted to talk. And we went in. By that time, the issue of tapes and so forth was so sensitive. We went in and turned all the water taps on so we could talk without being overheard. I don't think it was tape, it was bugged, but everybody was paranoid by that time. Elliot said, we have to resign if we can't indict Agnew, don't we? I said, yes, we do.
And Bork said a vice president could be tried on charges by the regular courts.
Agnew had been trying to escape a trial in the courts. He claimed the constitutional process was for a vice president to be impeached before the Congress.
My view was less technical. I was concerned about having two impeachment have the idea of impeachment in the air, as of an actual impeachment proceeding going on, that it would liable to be contagious.
Nixon saw the point. He chose the lesser of two evils and let Agnew's prosecution go ahead. But the vice president had one more trick up his sleeve. He turned a public appearance in California into a demonstration of his support among the party faithful.
You're very kind. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate the warmth of your greeting. I want to say at this point, clearly and unequivocally, I am innocent of the charges against me. I will not resign if indicted. I will not resign if indicted.
It was Agnew's last stand. Outside his hard right constituency, he had no backing. So secretly, he offered both to resign and plead guilty to a lesser charge, provided he not be sent to prison. The Attorney General gathered his team to consider Agnew's proposal. To the prosecutors who built the case, the whole idea was an affront to the principle of equal justice.
You don't give this guy a significantly better deal than you'd give anybody else who had done that just because he's blackmailing the Department of Justice by, in effect, saying, if you don't give me the deal I want, you know, I'm going to stay in the vice presidency and maybe become president.
But Henry Peterson, the most senior civil servant in the room, saw a different problem.
I had just made some presentation, the importance of treating this guy equally, which meant very harshly. And Peterson paced up and down, and he had his hands thrust in his belt, which was his way, and he literally yelled, the man is the goddamn vice president of the United States, Barney. What do you want to do, make him crawl on his belly?
Richardson agreed. He guaranteed Agnew would not go to jail. In return, the vice president promised to resign. He set out for the Baltimore courthouse as vice president. Then his letter of resignation was delivered. So he appeared before the judge as a private citizen. He pleaded guilty to tax evasion and was fined.
Mr. Vice President, where's the best place?
In Agnew, the law had claimed a mighty victim. The president set about making certain that he would not be next.
We had concluded the discussion of the Agnew matter, as we were walking to the door, the president said something like, well, now that that has been dealt with, we can go ahead and get rid of Cox.
I mean, it was head-to-head warfare. It was a struggle for Richard Nixon's presidency. And he approached his attitude towards Cox was on that basis, not a matter of some disagreement over a legal issue, but it was life and death of his presidency.
Cox's demand for the White House tapes was moving to a climax in the courts. He'd won the opening rounds, but the president's lawyers doggedly took the case to appeal.
I'd like to be successful in some case, somewhere, sometime. So far, I haven't won a thing.
On the day he chose his new vice president, Nixon lost again. The U.S. Court of Appeals ruled against him, 5-2. The judges said he could appeal to the Supreme Court to overturn all previous decisions in the case, which didn't look likely, or else he had to give up the tapes. They gave the president just 1 week to make up his mind until midnight the following Friday.
We saw a very, very serious problem in that the president was not going to give up the tapes. He was determined not to.
What are you going to do if a president disobeys the order? That was a terribly worrisome thing.
The confrontation could not have come at a worse time. The Arab states had just launched a massive attack on Israel. As the US and the Soviet Union mounted airlifts to their respective allies, superpower tensions escalated towards a nuclear crisis.
This unhappy concurrence of Nixon going nose to nose with his two great enemies in the world, Leonid Brezhnev and Archibald Cox, had the makings of grand tragedy in it.
When it came to facing down Russians, the president could act directly. But he couldn't fire Cox. He'd given away that power to the Attorney General. So Nixon had his chief of staff summon Richardson.
I walked into Haig's office on Monday morning, and he started updating me on what was going on in the Middle East. It was getting very tense.
It seemed the perfect way to win over this former defense secretary and expert on Middle East policy.
This went on for quite a while. And I finally said, Al, when do you want me to go? I'm ready to go home and pack my bags. I can leave any time. And then he said, well, Elliot, that's not really what I... No, I have another problem.
You know, it was very clear that following Agnew's resignation, that the president was then determined to get rid of Mr. Cox. And the whole special prosecutor apparatus says that he'd been set up.
And I said to Al, if you do that, you leave me no choice but to resign. And he said, well, there may be some other way of dealing with the problem.
The other way, which Haig persuaded Richardson to support, was a plan to satisfy the court and keep Cox's hands off the tapes. The White House would pick just one person to listen to the tapes. This ingenious ruse was dreamed up by one of Nixon's lawyers, Fred Buzzard.
Fred Buzzard came into my office with a gleam of hope in his eyes, which was not normally there, and said, Al, we have a solution that I think we may be able to cobble together, which would involve the turnover of the tapes to John Stennis of the Senate.
The senator, a 72-year-old Southern conservative, was a loyal Nixon supporter.
I went down for a very hurried little conference that didn't last over 15 minutes or 20 maybe. Monday afternoon of this week by Mr. Fred Bazard. And of course, I know he was talking for the White House. He was talking for the president.
Stennis was to listen to the tapes and verify the accuracy of written summaries prepared by Nixon and his lawyers. The prosecutors would have to settle for these summaries, not the tapes.
Well, it was phony. As phony as could be. Why pick Senator Stennis? First, he was a terrific senator for many years, but he was an old man, he couldn't hear, and he was going to listen to the tapes, and he was going to prepare a version. It was phony as it could be.
They had a picture of John Stennis in Time magazine with his hand to his ear, and a caption which said, "Technical help needed." And I saw that, and I laughed so loudly that I almost fell on the floor, and as I looked up, I saw the pointy shoes of Richard Nixon looking down at me, and he did not see the humor in the situation.
I can only say that the fact that John Stennis had a problem with hearing does not mean that he could not, with the devices that are available to turn up the volume, have heard as well as anybody else.
Cox couldn't possibly agree to the plan. His list of objections focused on Stennis. He said that the task couldn't be entrusted to any one man. But the president wouldn't budge. He wasn't going to appeal to the Supreme Court, and he certainly wasn't going to turn over the tapes. Instead, on Friday morning, with the midnight deadline looming, he had Haig call Richardson back to the White House.
It was a strange meeting. I could only call it a rancid meeting.
The message to Richardson was that he was to ban Cox from issuing any more subpoenas to the president.
That, of course, put the situation in a very different light from what I had been willing to support. It's one thing to say you'll get an honest version of what is in the tapes from Stennis. And quite another to say to the prosecutor, you can't go after additional evidence of the same kind.
The White House was counting on Cox to resign in protest when he received the ban. If he did not, then the president's survival hung on Richardson. Would he sack Cox for defying the president?
The question of what I would do in that event did not arise.
It was a crucial misunderstanding, for Nixon's men thought they could rely on Richardson to do their bidding.
If Cox refused to abide by the transcripts and terminate request for additional tapes, he would be fired.
There was agreement that Elliot Richardson was, in the language of that day and subsequent days, on board and was in agreement with the plan.
Haig reported to Nixon that Richardson might grumble, but they could count on him. The two men took a final stroll in the White House grounds before announcing, as if it were a concession, that the president would meet the court order by handing over tape summaries verified by Senator Stennis.
Late, indeed, I think I'd gone home. I got a call from Elliot Richardson saying, here's what's happened.
What had happened was that the president had gone over Richardson's head and himself issued the order, banning Cox from further attempts to obtain tapes, notes, or memoranda of presidential conversations. Without delay, the prosecutor turned the tables on the president.
So at that point, I turned around and came back in town to the offices in Washington. Called Jim Doyle, who was very close to me, was a public relations advisor and press man and so forth.
This is Jim Doyle from Archibald Cox's office. I have a statement that I'm going to read as fast as you can take it. It's from Special Prosecutor Archibald Cox.
Newspaper deadlines were only 5 minutes away. Oh, I made a very short statement saying I intended to carry on with my job on the terms on which I'd accepted it.
In my judgment, the president is refusing to comply with the court decrees, period. I shall bring these points to the attention of the court and abide by its decision. Paragraph. Notes.
Cox scheduled a formal press conference for the next morning. The nation waited for the showdown between the president and the defiant prosecutor. Cox struck first, and the TV networks carried it live.
Good afternoon. This is the ballroom at the National Press Club in Washington, where Archibald Cox, the special Watergate prosecutor, is about to hold a press conference.
I read in one of the newspapers this morning the headline, Cox Defiant. I do want to say that I don't feel defiant. In fact, I told my wife this morning I hate a fight.
Indeed, to be honest, back home before we went to the press conference, I was in tears over having to do it. I kept thinking of the occasion when I was a boy, about 12 years old, when a friend of my father's had been asked by President Coolidge, I suppose it was, to do something, and he had agreed to do it, giving up something he personally very much wanted to do. And I had said to Father, Father, why did Mr. So-and-so agree to do that when he didn't want to? And the response was, when the President of the United States asks you to do something, you do it.
On this occasion, Cox was not going to do it. He explained in a fireside chat to the nation why the law had to come first.
When criminal wrongdoing is the subject of investigation, it is simply not enough to make a compromise in which the real evidence is available only to two or three men operating in secrecy.
You consider the tapes absolutely vital to the case yourself?
I think it is vital to know.
Clarify or amplify, if possible, the two questions.
Decided. I have sort of a naive belief, if you'll forgive me for being corny, that what's right will prevail in the end.
I'll give you the document.
I frankly was stunned by how well he did, because Archie was not totally a public person. And this was, in the good sense, a superb political effort. It was absolutely convincing. It was human. It was almost endearing.
Any way whatsoever.
Then my question, sir, was how could you expect to succeed in this job? How could you expect to succeed?
Well, I thought it was worth a try. I thought it was important. If it could be done, I thought it would help the country. And if I lost, what the hell?
Mr. Cox, let me ask you. Excuse me, Mr. Cox. The report is over here.
I'm very sorry. Yes.
By the time the news conference was finished, even the skeptical Washington press corps had been won over.
I don't know the answer to that.
Sir, you are a great American.
At Cox's public show of defiance, Nixon resolved to have him sacked at once. For the Attorney General and his immediate subordinates, the moment of decision had come.
Richardson's secretary put her head in the door and said, the Attorney General would like to see you. And I went in, and there was Ruckelshaus and Richardson and, two or three of Richardson's young aides. And I still, it still hadn't crossed my mind what was going to happen.
It was clear that Cox was going to go. It was only a question of how, not whether. Elliot said, I'm not going to do it. And I said, well, not me either. I decided that some time ago. I'm not interested in being part of this exercise.
And at that moment, for the first time, it occurred to me that I was the third in line in the Department of Justice.
At that moment, Richardson said to Bork, well, Bob, what are you going to do? You're next.
I said, let me think. And I got up and I began pacing around the office while they talked about something else. And finally, I said, yes, I can fire him, but I'll resign immediately afterwards.
Bork said that he felt, that he had felt for some time that Cox was not conducting himself correctly, that he was not doing his job right, and indeed should be fired.
And so Ruckelshaus and I said, well, in these circumstances, Bob, you will have to go ahead and fire him. We can't have a situation in which this goes all the way down to some deputy assistant attorney general, with everybody above him having left. The business of the government has to go on.
The president was frantic to prevent a rash of resignations at the Justice Department. He stood by as White House counsel Len Garment phoned the attorney general. But Richardson was firm. When appointed, he had undertaken to protect Cox's independence, and he would not now break his word.
The president said, I'm not surprised that that pious bastard cares more for his ass than his country.
We were all very stricken by the moment. And Richardson left to present his resignation to the president.
The beginning of the conversation was really quite tense and difficult because he started talking about the Middle East. This was the President of the United States, Commander-in-Chief. And he went on to say, do you realize that Brezhnev could make a very serious miscalculation in the light of what could happen if you go forward? I was considerably shaken, but I said, Mr. President, I don't feel that I have any choice. I cannot do it. And the president said, Elliot, I'm sorry you choose to put your purely personal commitments ahead of the public interest. And I could feel the blood rushing to my head, and I could have made a very angry response. But what I did say, in as level of voice as I could muster, I said, Mr. President, it would appear that you and I have a different perception of the public interest.
No one yet knew it, but the Saturday Night Massacre had begun. Next on the list was Richardson's deputy, William Ruckelshaus. Al Haig telephoned him with an ultimatum. Fire Cox, you've no choice.
Haig went into the crisis in the Middle East. He finally mentioned, didn't you realize this was an order from your commander-in-chief? This was after several minutes of conversation, and I said, come on, Al, what are you gonna do, get a tank down here and blow me out of my office? I can't do this.
General reaction to the developments today?
Well, there'll be an announcement out of the White House later on. I can't say a thing.
There will be?
Does it have to do with the resignation of the Attorney General?
Well, it might, but you'll have to get it from them.
Excuse me.
Thank you, Bill.
When Ruckelshaus went home, the press was still in the dark about how many attorney generals Nixon had gone through. The succession now passed to the number three man at the Justice Department.
So I got in Bork, the Solicitor General, a great constitutional lawyer.
Bob Bork was a different kind of fellow. He was a patriot, and I think a jurist of renowned dimensions, far better than either of his two superiors.
I went downstairs, and there were a White House driver, Bizarre in the back seat, Garment in the right front seat, the passenger seat.
And we plunked him down between... He sat between Bizarre and myself, so he couldn't bolt out of the door.
We went over to the White House, to Haig's office. And Haig began explaining the international situation and how the president couldn't be faced down and so forth. And I said, I'm going to fire him. The only question is whether I resign immediately afterwards or not. He didn't look like he was interested too much in whether I resigned immediately afterwards or not, as long as I fired him. Haig took me to the Oval Office. And as I recall, the lights were kind of dim in there, and the place was very gloomy. They had not planned this kind of a massacre at all.
At home in a smart Washington suburb, Cox waited for the inevitable.
He did call me early in the evening, and he said he had received notice from the White House that a messenger was on the way.
It's only 20 minutes from the White House. And 20 minutes went by, 40 minutes went by, an hour went by, nothing happens.
And then I got another call, and Archie said the messenger had gotten lost, and so he still hadn't heard.
Finally, there's rapping on the front door, and a disheveled driver appears and had a message which he handed me.
Nixon was finally rid of his turbulent prosecutor. But it would prove harder still to abolish Cox's office and sack his staff.
Saturday morning, got up, and my wife and I, we took the kids, and we went to Luray Caverns for the day. Didn't have the radio on, no TV, just quietness. We're coming home, the kids are asleep in the car. Put the key in a door, and the telephone's ringing. So my wife goes in and answers the phone. I'm yelling, don't answer the phone. She goes in to answer the phone, and she says, it's for you. I says, oh, no.
Angelo Lano was the FBI agent who'd worked longest on the Watergate case. The call was from his boss.
He said, Richardson's been fired, Cox has been fired, and you have to get over and take over the prosecutor's office. And I said, what? And I said, wait a minute. I said, who told you this?
Acting Attorney General Bork's second order that night caused almost as much uproar as the first. It was issued to protect prosecution documents from the prosecutors.
Haig told me that these documents were disappearing from the special prosecutor's office. Shouldn't we put the FBI around there? And I said, yes.
Having done a difficult evening's duty, Robert Bork went home.
The streets were pitch dark by this time, of course, and as I came out of the driveway of the Department of Justice, photographers from the press leapt out of the bushes. and I was quite surprised that this picture of me looking like an axe murderer.
The outcry was just beginning.
The office of the Watergate Special Prosecution Force has been abolished.
When the White House announced what they'd done, the media reported it as a naked attempt by the president to overthrow the rule of law.
The country tonight is in the midst of what may be the most serious constitutional crisis in its history. The president has fired the special Watergate prosecutor, Archibald Cox, and he has sent FBI agents to the office of the special prosecution staff and to the attorney general and the deputy attorney general, and the president has ordered the FBI to seal off those offices. That's a stunning development, and nothing even remotely like it has happened in all of our history.
We had no idea whether the Army was coming, the Marines. We had no idea whether our files would be taken away from us. We were told nothing.
Halfway through dinner, the phone rang. It was Hank Ruth, and he said, Archie's been fired. Get to the office and save the evidence.
The young prosecutors got there before Angelano, the FBI man they'd always worked with.
So it went up, a couple of the assistant prosecutors were there, and they said, and started yelling at me.
Accused him of treachery, treason, working with the enemy, having been a pawn of the White House. We put it every which way we could.
So finally, Henry Ruth shows up, and I figured, oh, my salvation. So Hank comes in, and I said, we go into the office, and I said, Hank, first of all, I don't want to be here. And I told him what had happened.
And I said, whose side are you on, Angie? Are you with us, or are you against us? And he said, I'm just doing my job. And I said, well, where are your written orders, Angie?
You know, and I just said, take it out on somebody else. You know, I didn't want to come here. I don't want to be here. And I'm going to get out of here as quick as I can.
He said, nothing goes in and nothing goes out. And I said, well, Suppose I have some personal letters from my wife or something like that. He said, you can't take them out.
I don't remember that. It was so hot in there that night. You know, if I did, you know, I'm sorry, but that was life. That's the way it went.
Excuse me, boss.
Despite the FBI and the late hour, the special prosecutor's office was besieged by reporters.
Continuing the investigation.
We were told they were going to stop anybody.
But could you tell me my name is?
We're stopping you from going out.
Our press guy, Jimmy Doyle, came into my office finally and grabbed me and said, "We're going upstairs." And I said, "What for?" And he said, "The press is up there. You should have done this a long time ago." And marched me upstairs to a very small room where we had our library. And it seemed like the entire Washington Press Corps was in there. It was smoky, it was dark. It was really mayhem.
I must say, I suppose that human emotions take over in this kind of occasion, because one thinks that in a democracy, maybe this would not happen, and that maybe we could proceed in good faith to prosecute those who have violated the criminal law. Apparently that is not to be the case, and we have been abolished.
The special news bulletins carried on late into the night.
The Tonight Show will not be seen tonight, so that we may bring you the following NBC News special report.
Mr. Cox's comment when he was told that he was apparently about to be fired was, "Whether ours shall continue to be a government of laws and not of men is now for Congress and ultimately the American people."
An investigator appointed to investigate scandals was fired because he insisted on investigating scandals.
That the president may have an even more grave constitutional crisis on his hands.
In my career as a correspondent, I never thought I'd be announcing these things.
After Cox, now Richardson and Ruckelshaus were marked out as martyrs to the cause of justice.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
An astonishing thing is happening here. He is getting an applause. Not necessarily from the reporters, but from the Justice Department employees who are, as you see, lining the balcony. This is unusual.
Richardson's successor, on the other hand, didn't enjoy being cast as the villain of the piece.
And I have asked all the personnel in the department to stay and help keep the department going in this extraordinarily difficult time. About the prosecutions.
Well, I did something I had never done before. I went into the press room.
General Hay, General Hay,
General Hay, did you order the FBI to
take over the offices on Saturday night? And if so, why?
Guilty.
General Hay.
In the midst of this chaos, the White House failed to ensure that Cox's staff were given formal notices of dismissal. So the rump force of special prosecutors sat tight.
The White House announced last night that you were abolished. Now, when did you begin to get word that you weren't abolished?
You know, the White House announced we were abolished, but if they announce the sky is green and then you look up and the sky is blue, now, I presume that in the normal course of events that to abolish an agency takes some time. We are going to try like hell. We are a criminal prosecution force. We have reason to believe there's been some serious crime, and we want to prosecute it.
That's the White House now. It's very hard to describe how it feels to be fired by a president and disobey. All of a sudden, bundles of envelopes started to be dropped on our floor, and these were telegrams from the American people saying, "Hang in there. Stay there. Don't leave." And everybody was really caught up.
A record 150,000 telegrams condemning the president flooded Washington that weekend. Western Union had to call in extra workers and reprogram its computers to handle this firestorm of protest. Congress now began talking impeachment.
Most of the telegrams are short. They just say, impeach Richard Nixon or force him to resign.
Even though Cox was gone, Nixon still had to respond to the court order for the tapes. He had to recall his lawyer, who'd already flown home to Texas.
I'm afraid that was over-optimistic after what happened yesterday.
The lawyers waited for instructions. Would the president bow to the wave of protest or continue defiant? He had until the court hearing on Tuesday.
We had no idea what Charles Allen Wright was going to say. No idea at all. I thought we were headed towards some kind of need to bring a contempt action against the president. There were no speeches, there was no preamble. Charles Allen Wright just got up and said,
there would have been those who would have said that the president is defying the law. This president does not defy the law.
At which some of us almost broke out laughing, given the events of 3 days previous. And then he said the president would turn over the tapes that had been requested. Extraordinary.
I would say these people are going to cost $1 million over the next...
When Richard Nixon yielded and agreed to hand over the tapes, he knew they could destroy him. Soon, everyone would know.